Rapiers can't cut. That's apparently what some people say, or do they? Who says that rapiers can't cut? There may be some people in the world who believe that rapiers can't cut, but of course they can cut. They are cut and thrust swords. Yes, they are by definition, I'll talk about that in a second, they are thrust-centric swords. So they have been specialised to the thrust, yeah? They are, generally speaking, longer than something like a medieval arming sword, but they're also, generally speaking, narrower. Now, when you make something long and narrow, you generally, if you want it to be an effective thrusting sword, also want it to be stiff. And in doing so, you have to give it a certain edge geometry that means that it's probably not the best cutter in the world. And I think this is the point that some people have taken, they've strawmanned the argument and they've taken it too far. So people who are big, you know, big rapier fans, rapierists, who basically feel that some people are saying, oh, the rapier's cuts are, you know, nothing, they should be ignored. And of course, they quite rightly point out that the rapier treatises of the 16th and 17th centuries do in fact show cuts. It is a cut and thrust sword, we know that. Okay, so absolutely, you can make cuts with the sword. And funnily enough, this very sword, when I use it in fencing, when I do hit people with it, it has the capacity to hit quite hard because it's long. And you know, every sword, doesn't matter what type of sword you're talking about, is a lever, okay? And the end of the lever is going to be moving quicker a lot of the time if it is longer, okay? Just saying, if you hit someone with a pole axe or a quarter staff or any kind of pole arm, you've got a lot of acceleration at the tip, and you actually get that with a rapier. Does that mean that it cuts well? Well, let's unpackage that. Cut what? cut paper, cut a dead pig, cut a person wearing clothing, cut mail armour, cut wood. So all of those things are very, very different targets, and different types of tool or weapon are going to cut different things more or less well. Now, the funny thing is when we look at cutting water bottles, for example, or cutting a sheet of paper, you need a very specific type of tool to do that. In the Victorian period, for example, they had different types of sword for different sword feats, so different showing off displays, basically. So they had a handkerchief cutter sword, which is very light, it's actually quite like a rapier in some ways, very light, very fine, very sharp. It wouldn't be very good as a battlefield weapon, the handkerchief cutter, because it's too fragile, but it's razor sharp edge, literally razor sharp edge, very, very thin as well, a very thin edge geometry. So it would be very fragile used in combat, but excellent at cutting through silk handkerchiefs. So it's great. That is a great cutter. Is it great at cutting bars of lead? No, it's useless at cutting bars of lead. So what you use for cutting bars of lead is a naval cutlass or a lead cutter, which isn't even like a scaled up naval cutlass. So different types of swords are good for cutting different things. So when people say that the rapier is a good cutter or a bad cutter or can't cut, those are very, very relative things that need to be put in their correct context. And obviously what we're talking about most of the time is cutting a person who's trying to fight you through some degree of clothing, usually, but not always, because bear in mind they might have a bare head, their hat might have flown off or come off, or you might be hitting them underneath the hat. They might have bare hands, they may possibly have bare arms. I know lots of rapier treatises show people in the nude with a fig leaf or with a loincloth or whatever, but generally speaking, in a duel you're dealing with clothed people, and clothing is surprisingly difficult to get through with cuts, and surprisingly, disturbingly, you might say, easy to get through with thrusts. That's an aside, that's a separate point. But basically, if you're cutting a human opponent who's wearing clothes, clearly some swords are going to cut better than others. So if we accept, yep, absolutely, a rapier can cut, does cut, they were used to cut, cuts are shown in all of the rapier treatises, pretty much all the rapier treatises you want to look at. I'm going to bring an exception into that rule in a minute, but if you accept that the average rapier, yes, indeed, is a cut and thrust sword, that is true, we accept that. However, when we look at something like a side sword or a saber, or even a spadone, okay, or a montante, whatever you want to call it, do you think that those things cut against a human opponent in close, do you think they cut better or worse than a rapier? So let's put this in relative terms. So say, for example, do you think a sharpened rapier of this form, which is a 1630, 1640 English style of rapier, compared to a 13th century, 14th century arming sword, which of those do you think is going to cut a human target wearing clothes better? Well, I hope the answer is fairly obvious. I mean, this is not a specialised thrusting sword. Yes, it's got a pointy blade, but the point of balance is much further from the hand. It's got a lot more blade width. Importantly, I mentioned edge geometry earlier. Actually, these swords weigh about the same. Okay, they're both about 3 pounds off the top of my head, but they are very, very different shapes. And you can see the rapier has gained length, but it has become more narrow to stay the same weight. And he's got more hilt. He's got more weight at the back end. But the edge geometry, therefore, is less conducive with the narrower blade than the broader blade. Equally, let's put the arming sword down for a second. Which of these do you think is going to cut better? Well, probably the answer is fairly obvious and fairly clear. There are certain swords that are designed for cutting more than the rapier is. And quite simply, if the rapier were as good at cutting as those other swords, as the arming sword or the sabre or a falchion or a langmesser or a side sword or a zweihander, then surely no one ever would have kept using those broader swords, would they? Those broader swords that are with the point of balance further from the hand, with different edge geometry, that are, let's face it, better for cutting, existed because they're better for cutting. That is their forte. That is what they're good at. That's not really what the rapier is good at, but that doesn't mean that you can't cut with it, okay? I also want to throw in a couple of other things here. So number one, we talk about rapiers, and as I have said so many times, it is very, very difficult to define what is a rapier. If I put a broader blade on this, would it still be a rapier? Would it be a rapier because it's got a rapier hilt? I would say no. I personally would call that a side sword. Possibly, at a certain point, I might call it a broadsword or a backsword, depending what type of blade it's got on it. Equally, if this had a completely square section blade, like an estoc, you wouldn't be able to cut with it, would you? Now, this is the second point I want to make. So number one, rapier, how do we define what a rapier is? The dividing line between a side sword, being a modern term, spada da lato or side sword, the dividing line between side sword and rapier, where does one end and the other begin? We can't really say. Historically, the term rapier was used by different people in different places to mean slightly different things, which I maybe will go into in a separate video. But there are some rapiers which I would argue virtually can't cut. And there are some examples in the Wallace collection, for example, where you look at, they could cut maybe at the base of the blade, these, but once you go from about the middle of the blade upwards, if you look at the blade geometry, so if you hacksawed through the blade and looked down at the top of it, they are virtually square. Now, I'm not saying that you can't make a square razor sharp at the edge. Technically you can. It's very difficult, certainly using Renaissance techniques. You can technically make any two planes that meet together into a razor edge. That does not mean that it will cut well as a sword. It doesn't even mean that we'll necessarily cut at all, certainly not through clothes, because of the edge geometry. So cutting doesn't always come down to how a blade looks like this and its silhouette, but it also doesn't always come down to its sharpness. You can make something razor sharp and it still won't cut for crap because the edge geometry is so fat. And that's one of the issues that we have with many types of rapier. When they get very narrow up here, if the edge geometry is close enough to square, the edge geometry is so bad for cutting that in reality they're never going to cut through clothes. That's not to say that they won't still do damage with a blow. And as mentioned, this is a blunt training sword. This still hits really hard. It could still break a finger, still disconcert someone. So you can still hit someone really hard, but it doesn't mean it's actually going to cut through things and cleave things. Right, so to finish off and summarise, I hope I've been relatively concise here. Yes, absolutely, a rapier, although how we define rapier is open to interpretation, but an average rapier, I think most people would agree this is a rapier. If this was sharp, yes, this would cut, okay? Would it cut as well as an arming sword or a saber or a falchion? No, it wouldn't. But it would still cut well enough for cuts to be of usefulness in an average fight. So let's put this to bed. This topic has gone on and on. It keeps being revived like every few months. Rapiers, get it into your heads. They are not fencing foils. They are large cut and thrust swords that weigh about the same as a medieval knight's sword, as an arming sword. Okay? They are cut and thrust swords. Yes, they are. By definition, the rapier is specialised to the thrust. It has put more of its energy into evolving towards the point, but it can still cut in most cases, maybe in 95% of cases of rapiers. And finally, let's not go over the top. Let's accept that these, whilst these don't cut as well, generally speaking, as swords which are more designed for, with cutting in mind, there are a few rapiers, and certainly the small swords, once we get into the world of transitional rapiers and small swords, there are some rapiers and there are certainly some small swords that basically can't cut in real terms. So let's not go too far in the other direction and say that all rapiers are amazing cutters, because that's undermining our own veracity and kind of our own the seeking the truth and the correct vision of where these are in history. Anyway, I hope that's been useful and interesting. I suspect that this topic will continue to come up for many years to come, and I'm sure that I'll probably have to make more videos on this topic. But thanks for watching. Give me a like and a subscribe if you haven't done already. Share the video, and I'll see you really soon for another video soon on Scholar Gladiatoria channel. Cheers, folks. Thanks for watching. We've got extra videos on Patreon. Please give our Facebook a like and subscribe if you haven't already. Cheers, folks.